Hello, welcome to another edition of the Mike Zielinski Show. I'm Mike Zielinski. My guest today is Normandy Albert. Welcome, Normandy.
Thank you.
Normandy is a young entrepreneur and self-styled fashionista. And she has started her own high-heeled industry, creating her own shoes, because even though there are a million shoes out there, you can't find shoes you really like until you made your own,
right?
Correct?
Yep, exactly.
And the story of how you've done this is pretty interesting. And your background is, your family has owned ATV Bakery for years, and anybody who's lived in Berks County or driven in Reading, and especially like early in the morning and smelled the Italian bread, ATV, awesome place. And you grew up in the family business. You're still helping out there. You're one of the general managers, but you started this side business, and just because you couldn't find shoes. And so tell me about that. You have to be kidding me. You couldn't find shoes.
Yeah, pretty much. Well, I was looking for a specific shoe. So when I started the search for this shoe, I wasn't searching for it, not expecting to find the shoe.
Okay.
So then once I started looking at department stores and I started Googling and I realized that I'm not going to find this shoe anywhere, I resorted to kind of sketching what I wanted it to look like.
And we're talking about luxury, highly decorative
shoes. Yeah, absolutely. And even though I wanted something luxurious, I didn't want a $2,000 or $3,000 price tag.
Right.
And that was what I was seeing along the lines of what I was looking for.
So how does one manufacture such a shoe at an affordable price?
Well, basically, you just can't have high profit margins, you know.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, the others are marked
up. It's not that my shoes are costing less than other big designers. They're costing about the same. I just don't feel the need to make $1,000 or $1,500 off of a pair of shoes. Somebody like a big designer can do that because people know them and they can get away with it. But I don't really see the need for it if I'm going for affordable.
Okay, what's interesting, you weren't a designer.
I was not.
You you majored in pre-law, philosophy, and religion, which I think there is no graphic thing for, of those majors. So you've designed your own shoes.
Yeah.
And the story gets even more interesting. Tell us about what was next.
Which part was next?
Well, after you had these sketches, you had to turn them into images.
Right. So I started looking for professional, like basically a mechanical engineer, because that's the only way that you can make a professional blueprint. And I found out that it's $4,000 to $5,000 for each sketch just to have made into a blueprint with all your sides. So I started thinking about how I could do this without spending thousands and thousands of dollars. And eventually it popped into my mind that I made a blueprint at one point in my life in woodshop class. And
And you had no idea when you made it that that would...
No, not at all. It wasn't... I mean, I probably had like no interest in blueprinting at all
whatsoever.
You had
to take it because it was required at Muhlenberg?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I remembered that I had made them in that class, and I reached out to my teacher from that point in time, Mr. Hanneberry, Bill Hanneberry, and he agreed to help me, and he did an awesome job. We spent probably, I don't know, 9 or 10 months of him teaching me how to make blueprints, and it was fun. It was good. So now I know how to do something that costs thousands of dollars to be able to do.
And that's interesting, because you had to be innovative and find affordable ways to help you pursue your dream.
Right.
So once that happened, then you, who helped you find a factory in Italy?
Well, it just was kind of by chance. I was complaining to a friend. I used to live in Miami. And I was complaining to a friend who lived in Miami about the fact that I keep getting to a certain point and then I can't go any farther because I don't know how to get there. So I was telling her that, how am I going to find a manufacturer? I'm going to have to go to Italy and walk around and just hope that I stumble upon a good factory. And she said, I think I might know someone that could possibly help you.
Wow.
So she put me in touch with her boss. And her boss basically had a clothing company that he had a woman help him find the factory for. So he put me in touch with the woman that helped him find his factory, and she started working for me and helped me find my factory.
And you've now, you have produced your first shoe.
I have.
And it's it has a watermelon theme, because it came out, what, last summer?
Yeah, it came out right before the summer.
Oh, this summer?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay, so it's really fresh.
Yeah, a couple months old.
And it has an interesting name.
Yes, yeah, Anguria.
But, yeah, and because it has an Italian theme because it was manufactured in Italy.
Right.
And you're telling me that Italian manufacturers connotes quality in the high-end fashion.
Yeah, absolutely.
Industry.
When people go to buy something of good quality, I think that they will look for things made in Italy because they know that people that have things made in Italy, it's a very good quality. People in Italy don't compromise when it comes to quality. So there's no better place to go than there.
Now show us your creation.
This is the first heel, the Anguria heel, the watermelon pump. And basically this is the most simple design, which is why I started. I didn't want to shock people too much. So this seemed like the best bet. It's a more of a simple heel and just looks like a piece of watermelon.
It does. And what's it? What's of kind of material is that? Because it looks plastic. But
it's leather. This is patent leather.
Okay.
And this is basically, it's a rubber sole, a rubber bottom, a cork insole with extra padding. And this is, I think, something that's similar to like a PVC, basically like a polyvinyl chloride. It's a hardened plastic material.
Okay, maybe that's what I was saying. Now, you also told me that was designed with comfort in mind, you know, and I'm skeptical about that because it looks uncomfortable, but
the first compliment after people just saying that they really like the shoe, the first compliment I get when they try it on is how comfortable it is.
Yeah.
And I just wanted, if I was going to do this, I was going to do it right. And the worst part about wearing high heels is if the high heel is super uncomfortable, then it's like there's no point in having such a beautiful high heel when you can only wear it for 30 minutes without being
in
pain.
And you could wear that all day long.
Yeah, I've worn this for 7 or 8 hours and I've been perfectly fine in them, and that's not too normal.
So what does, first of all, your business right now is all online. What do people have to pay for that shoe?
$315 retail.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And the demographic, is anybody who, and there's a lot of women, you have a nice age demographic because women into their 40s, 50s, if they're into fashion,
right,
wear high heels.
They'll still wear it. Primarily, it's 18 to 35, but in bigger cities, women, it doesn't matter what age they are, if they like a high heel and it's, you know, something that they really want, they're going to buy it and they're going to wear it.
Is that because bigger cities are a little bit more cosmopolitan, would you say? Or?
Yeah, absolutely, for sure. They care. I think bigger cities are more of a show.
Besides the more affordable price in a luxury shoe, what else, from your opinion, distinguishes that from some of your competitors?
It has personality. You know, if you would do a search right now on shoes with themes or decorations, you're not going to find a heel that has the heel as something else. You know, there's decorations on the front and sometimes it'll go down the heel, but for the most part you have a typical stiletto or a pump or a wedge or a thick heel, and it's not a shape. And when I realized that there's not many shoes out there, if any at all, and the ones that are, like I said, are thousands of dollars, there's no shoes out there with a shape on it. So it's like high heels have been in existence for so long, I don't understand how we haven't.
Oh, I must say, though, and not for women, but I used to be a sports writer for many years. There was a running back for the Pittsburgh Steelers who was very flamboyant. His name was Frenchie Fuqua.
Uh-huh.
And he, I don't think he walked around in them 7-8 hours a day. It was a fashion statement. But he had high heels for a guy with goldfish floating inside.
That's so weird. Well, I was going to say high heels started out for men. The high heels were not originally for women.
Yeah, I just thought that was Frenchie being Frenchie.
No, nope. High heels started out for men who were royal, who didn't want to be shorter than women, so they put
high heels on. I guess Napoleon probably had high heels.
Probably, probably. But yeah, after all this time, most of the high heels still look exactly the same.
Yeah. Why do you think it became just female-oriented for the most part?
I'm not really sure. I think it's because women are in general more interested in fashion than men are. Men usually, you know, they'll put their outfit on and be ready to go, but women are very picky about their earrings and their accessories.
I would not want to be a woman, you know.
It's fun.
Oh, okay.
It's fun.
I guess that's a different perspective.
It's a lot of fun. I can, you know, dress up my life however I want.
How are sales been going so far?
Everything's been going well. I'm actually about to put a stop on my sales and go strictly to Kickstarter. And the remainder of my first order I'm going to give to people who fund me or back me on Kickstarter.
All right. And explain to our audience what exactly Kickstarter is.
Okay. Well, Kickstarter is a crowdfunding organization. Basically, it's all online. So basically, you start a campaign and you come up with a goal of however much it is that you think is realistic for you to be able to do what it is that you need to do. And you have to make a video and you have to give rewards away. So one of my rewards would be my shoes. And then not only that, but I won't be selling them. So they'll be a lot more limited and people will be more interested in buying them on Kickstarter. They'll be a little less than $315, so they'll get a better deal. But you have to give people a reason to want to be a part of your startup process. You know, people have to be interested in what it is that you're doing and you have to appeal to them. So if you are able to appeal to them, people are massively successful on crowdfunding.
And basically campaigns. Someone who does that, is that the only thing they're getting out of it, other than helping a young business person, is getting a better price?
I think it's more so for people who are really interested in helping people.
Okay.
I don't think that they're after the rewards, you know, because they can obviously go online and buy another pair of shoes if they want to, or they can go on my website right now and buy a pair of shoes if they want to. I think it's Kickstarter is sort of a family of people who have money and want to invest in people with different projects. And you're either successful or you're not. And if you're not and you don't raise the money that you set for your goal, then you don't get any of the money.
So this dream of yours, and I know you're working a second shoe, we'll get to that, but you know, you mentioned people with money. You come from a family that's for five generations has owned ATV Bakery, which is a very successful, you're more than just a bakery, right?
Yeah.
And you're telling me business is doing even better now than it's ever been. And I know you lived in Miami for a while, but you're back there working as the general manager. And it's a family business, and you love the bread. And you didn't really need to do this.
No.
You did this because this was a dream, and also you couldn't find a pair of shoes, right?
Yeah, I just wanted to be able to create something in this world that's kind of mine and go a little bit different. You know, my entire family is full of entrepreneurs, not just with ATV Bakery, but my grandfather, my great grandfather on the other side of my family built the first Chevy engine for NASCAR. So it's like, so it's in my
it's
blood.
It's not just bread.
It's not just bread. I mean, bread is super successful right now, but you know, I just wanted to kind of have a stake in the world. That was mine.
Yeah. No, I've been remiss. The name of your company, you know, your name is Normandy Albert. And,
yes.
And Normandy is just the name you got. None of your grandfather or father served at Normandy.
No.
And no one ever called you Norm, which you're grateful for, right?
Yes.
And you love the name Normandy now, but you hated it when you were younger.
Hated it.
And you love it now because it kind of sounds pretty sophisticated. You
know? Yeah, and it's different and nobody has it.
Yeah.
So it's just, you know, not me.
And the name of your company is Normandy Alberti.
Yes.
And that is the original family name. And tell us what happened to the I.
Well, my great-great-grandfather, Paolo Alberti, came over from Palermo,
right?
Sicily.
Yeah.
They cut the I off of our last name and he became...
In New York, went through immigration. Yeah.
And he became Paolo Albert. And when I found out that our name was Alberti, I was like, it's so pretty.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Not only that, it's one letter. I understand if it was this long,
drawn-out
name and they wanted to make it convenient, but it's one letter. So I said to my dad, that was in high school, I'm going to get it back someday.
Yeah, because it's funny because, I mean, you obviously look Italian-American and you don't look German American because Albert is
kind of sounds German. Yeah,
I don't know if maybe it's English. You know, there was a Prince Albert and a tobacco
Very
Prince
true.
Albert in a can. You know,
I have no idea what the actual origin is, but it's not mine.
Yeah, but Normandy Alberti sounds like a high-end, high-heel fashion product.
That was part of the decision making. It was like I got that from a lot of people. It already sounds like a fashion brand.
Now, Kickstarter obviously will help market your business.
Yeah.
How else will you get the word out about your shoes to the target audience you're pursuing?
Well, thankfully, social media is pretty big these days, and you are able to promote your business through social media in whatever area you want to. So if I want to go on Facebook or Instagram and run an ad specifically in Chicago, I can do that.
Yes.
And then I will see how many people viewed my ad and how many people clicked on
it. I use that for some of the other things I'm involved with, and you're absolutely right. I assumed you would do that.
Yeah. But I also think that being in person is a big, big deal. So I think that the best way besides social media marketing is to actually go to different cities and travel and meet as many people and network and go to, you know,
and so
stores.
When you go to these other cities, I mean, exactly where do you go? Do you go to fashion shows for shoes or?
Well, no, not fashion shows for shoes, but I'll go to venues and stores, especially that specialize in like decorative or higher end heels.
Okay.
So that way people who are familiar with that area already know what store to go to. And they may or may not see my shoe there.
You won some kind of entrepreneur award at the DoubleTree recently, right? Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, it was Women, Wine, and Shoes event at the DoubleTree.
I bet you that was a hit.
It was awesome. Yeah, it was so much fun. It was really, really a fun, good night and a great way to introduce yourself to other people who are involved in business, not in just the Reading area, but you know, all over the United States. And they had an award for Best in Shoe, and I won the award.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was really, really neat because I went by myself and I was nervous to go by myself and be around, you know, 2,000, 3,000 people. And but it was fun. It was really good. Everyone there was very, very nice. The people who ran it were awesome. You know, it was just a great time.
So that had to give you some validation that you're on the right track.
Yeah, that made me really happy.
Now tell us, go ahead.
No, it was just, that was a good night. That was my first, like, real public recognition, I guess.
Tell us about the second shoe that you're working on now.
The second shoe is a flame, basically. and just like with this shoe, it looks like a slice of watermelon. So the heel, instead of it looking like a typical heel, will look like you're walking on a flame.
So real hot-footed, huh?
Yeah. Exactly.
And that would be something that maybe, like if you're wearing in the wintertime, it'll melt ice and snow as you walk on.
Right.
You don't have to get out the snowblower.
No, you won't. Yeah. You can just walk down the street.
When do you anticipate launching that?
I would probably say that they'll be out around November. The great thing about Italy, if we all lived there, is that they don't work in the month of August. So everything that you're doing gets pushed back by a month. So I think they would probably be ready in the end of September or October, but because of this month,
everybody takes a holiday.
The whole month is a vacation.
Yeah.
So they're not working on my shoes right now at all, but they'll start on September 1st.
And you have not picked a name for that yet, right?
I have not.
Are you toying with some? Do you want to tease us with some possibilities?
No, I don't. I want to keep it a secret.
No,
I want to keep
fine.
It a secret.
I just was hoping for some breaking news here. You have ideas for other shoes, right?
Oh, yeah. I have about 30 sketches completed with blueprints ready to go.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh. So I have a lot of work done. It's just a very long process to get the shoe made that's never been made before, and they can't use the heel that they already have because it doesn't look like what I'm making. So that my shoe is made completely from scratch. They have to come up with new molds and new ways of making the shoe.
Now, do they make a set quantity?
You have to order a minimum of 100 pairs. So that's where I'm at right now. So.
And they obviously have everything in place. So if you need to have them do another 100 or hopefully another 500, it's
All the minimum requirement is 100 pairs. You can have as many made as you want or as many more than 100 or however often that you want them to be made.
What appeals most to you, or maybe it all does, the creative aspect of designing it, the manufacturing aspect, which you're involved with the design and part of the process with the blueprints, or the business aspect of it? And promoting
Definitely creative. I really like that I thought of something in my mind and it's a physical thing now. And I think it'll be really, really neat once, you know, it starts to become bigger and I see people out there and it's not a household name, but sort of a household name. That's what I'm going for anyway.
Yeah.
I want to be a big brand. So I think it's just an amazing thing to make something and think of something and then it be a part of the world that you live in.
And you're doing all this while, are you basically working full time at AT&T?
Yeah, yes.
So this is all done after hours?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, this is my night full time job. Yeah. So my day full time job is at the bakery. And then when I get home, I focus all my attention on the shoes.
Now you, I'm sure you get a lot of business tips from your family because they've been in business for many
years.
Although it's a different type of business.
It is. Yeah. It is different for sure. And I don't know too many people that are doing overseas manufacturing is the, I think, the tricky part that a lot of people don't know things about overseas manufacturing. So that's a learning by experience type thing. Everything else I can get advice for, a lot of advice for.
Yeah, but you knew where to look, or, you know, most of it was not coincidental. You just reached out to resources that you knew that could help you.
Pretty much. Yeah, yeah. I would think if I would get stuck and couldn't come up with a way to do something, then I would just keep thinking about somebody. I have to know someone that knows how to do this or knows somebody or can give me some kind of advice. And it just so happened to work out that way so far.
Do you have any free time with all this going
no,
on?
No, not at all. But that's okay. I don't mind it. I actually was just on vacation, so that was great. But then it's,
well, it is August, right?
So I get my vacation time in, and then it's, you know, work from start of the day to the end of the day, and that's how it should be if you're trying to be largely successful, you know?
You know, I know that Mike Zielinski has a worldwide audience, but I was asking you, it would be great if somehow you could wind up in Shark Tank, which obviously the show where they will invest in you, but they're sharks, and
they put you
in the tank, and you got to be good. But you're sharp on your feet, and you have... And you've toyed with this idea, right?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah.
I think it would be an incredible opportunity to work with somebody who's that successful and that big. Lori Grenier is one of the sharks, and she works for HSN. That's what it is.
Okay.
And she's very, very big on that. So I think that Shark Tank, if I had the opportunity and they took the bait, no pun intended, that it would work out well.
You've reached part of your goal now. I mean, you have a shoe that shoes that are on your feet, and they're cool and they're selling. But your ultimate goal, what is your benchmark for success?
My real benchmark is being able to be a philanthropist. I'm super passionate about fashion. But I feel like this is sort of a stairway. Oh yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
That's what, you know, this is really all about. Yeah.
We're burying the lead here. This is the best part. I didn't realize that. Yeah.
I have, you know, a goal for by the time I'm 50, there's things that I want to be able to do, and it's a lot of things, and I realize that all the things that I want to be able to do, like helping all these people, require a lot of money. So there's going to have to be some kind of way that I am able to make money, I just started with what I was passionate about.
Well, that's very laudable. What are some of your passions that you would like to help, you know, some of the causes?
I would love to be able to travel around the world and kind of educate people who don't have the best education systems, set up better education systems, and give more people an opportunity to do the things that a lot of people in America have opportunities to do and don't necessarily take advantage of it. And even inside of America, there's a lot of people that I just feel like they don't have access to enough things that open their eyes up to how far they can go in life.
Yeah, and those who don't in our country, it's unfortunate because this is one of the few countries in the world where you can do that.
Yeah.
That you can be born in with very tough circumstances and
Absolutely.
Rise above that, where there's some societies and some countries, well, that's not going to happen.
No.
Yeah.
No, and the uphill battle is a lot more steep than it is for, you know, me or anybody else that I know. And it's just, it's a dream to be able to, even if, you know, you don't get as far as you want to, I'm able to do this and I'm able to try. And I would love to be able to show people how much you can really do with your life if you want to.
Now, you're an employee of one, right? You, other than the people who help you, you have the factory.
Yeah, right, correct.
But just being online right now is basically what you're doing.
Yeah.
But you do have plans eventually to open up a brick and mortar store somewhere,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, absolutely. I would love that. I'd like to be able to open multiple stores, but thankfully, internet is a lot cheaper than renting a store.
Yeah, you don't need as much startup capital.
No,
right?
Yeah. So hopefully it'll go well enough and big enough, and some point in time I'll be able to get a store in a bigger city, you know, Miami or LA. Yeah.
We could do it Miami, LA, and Manhattan, but maybe you have some for sale at AT&T, right? ATV.
That'll be the special.
Yeah, people come in. Yeah, they'll come.
Bread and shoes.
You know, think about that. I gave you a tip there, you know.
Right.
I guess you have to clear that with your dad, right?
Yeah. And you can you know, fill your stomach with great bread and buy a pair of shoes at the same time. I don't think you can do that anywhere on the road.
What is it about, we're almost out of time, but what is it about women in shoes? What is the fascination?
I think that shoes are just jewelry for your feet, you know? There's no point in your feet being boring when you're going to spice up your ears and your neck and your, you know, your wrists and your fingers with rings, and then your feet are just what we see on everyday people. Why not wear something that, you know, is super different?
And, you know, from a male perspective, I mean, there is something really attractive in seeing a woman in high heels. You know,
I think so, too.
There's a sense of elegance, sophistication.
Absolutely. You know. And I think it's a sort of a hidden meaning that we can balance multiple things by walking.
That's your philosophy part of you're amazing. Hey, Normandy, thank you so much. I wish you all the success in the world. You're a delightful young lady.
Thank you very much.
I admire your chutzpah or whatever, of pulling this off. And congratulations.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
All right. For now, this is Mike Zielinski saying goodbye. Take care.